From that day on, anytime Jennifer tried to get him to dress up like a doll or do anything, he would say, "You're not the boss of me." And so for a long time, we heard this saying, "You're not the boss of me." And he was standing his ground because he figured out who the boss was. I want to share another little story here. We're talking about who's the boss. This is another true story of a governor from Massachusetts several years back. And when Christian Herter, governor of Massachusetts, was running hard for a second term in office, one day after a busy morning schedule chasing votes and not having time for lunch, he arrived at a church barbecue. It was late in the afternoon, and Herter was famished. And as Herter moved down the serving line, he held out his plate to the woman serving chicken. She put a piece on his plate and turned to the next person in line. "Excuse me," the governor said. "Do you mind if I have another piece of chicken?" "Sorry," the woman told him. "I'm supposed to give one piece of chicken to each person." "But I'm starved," the governor said. "Sorry," the woman replied. "Only one piece of chicken to a customer." Governor Herter was a modest and unassuming man, but he decided that this time he would throw a little weight around. "Do you know who I am?" he said. "I'm the governor. Hear me? I'm the governor of this state." The woman looked up, looked into his eyes, and said, "Do you know who I am? I'm the lady in charge of the chicken. Move along, mister." Governor found out who was the boss. I've got a question this morning. Who's the boss? Who's the boss? And when we ask that question, what we're really asking is, who's in charge? Who has authority? And in the context of that question, in the context in which I'm asking that question today, I'm not really asking the question, who's the boss, as it relates to who's the boss at home, or who's the boss at work, or who's boss in the women's social, or who's got the power politically, or who's the boss on the playground. But the question I'm asking this morning, as it relates to who's the boss, it's in the context of who's the boss spiritually in the kingdom of God. Who's in charge? Who has authority spiritually? Spiritually, as it relates to the kingdom of God. And how we answer that question is extremely important. And I want us to open our ears and allow the Spirit of God to reveal to us this answer. We're going to take a look at the question from the Bible and answer accurately that question, who's the boss? Look at Genesis chapter 1. Let's begin at the very beginning. Genesis chapter 1. Verse 26. Now, Genesis chapter 1 is where we find out the story of creation. We're given the revelation that God is the creator, that he created everything, heaven and earth. I want you to know, you and I did not come, creation did not come through a process of evolution. Genesis 1 gives us clearly the instruction that God created the heavens and the earth. He spoke into existence creation. He put the stars in the sky. He's the one that put fish in the ocean. We did not crawl out of the water up on the land in a pile of goo and all of a sudden turn into you. We didn't swing in the trees with the apes and then one day decide, you know what, I'd just rather walk around on the earth and jump out of the trees and then lose all that hair and change. It's not my message, but it's really amazing to me how people with, never mind. Everybody say, God is the creator. He also created us. And here in verse 26, Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, we find the description of God creating man. Then God said, verse 26, "Let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. Let them have dominion." Everybody say dominion. Dominion. That means authority. That means power. That means the boss. God created man in his image. He said, "Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, over the cattle, and over all the earth." Everybody say all.
All.
Over all the earth and over every creepy thing. So if you know some creeps, you've got authority over every creep. Verse 27, so God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. Then God blessed them. And God said to them, be fruitful and multiply. Fill the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves on the earth. Twice, God wanted to make clear and get across that when he created man, the human race, and put man on the earth, he gave man dominion. He gave man authority. Adam and Eve were the first of the human race. And through Adam and Eve, God gave all authority, all dominion to the human race, to all of mankind. And everything is going great. Adam goes ahead and names the animals and the plants, and he's taken authority. All of human race is ruling and taking dominion over all the creepy things and over all the animals, and they're ruling. They have dominion. They have perfect fellowship with God. They're walking with God. They're talking with God. No sickness, no disease. Everything is great. It is heaven on earth. God is awesome. God is good. Man is in charge, has dominion. But something terrible happens in Genesis chapter 3. There's a cataclysmic event that changes everything. Look at Genesis chapter 3. Everybody say, who's the boss? We're looking at that question. I want you to be thinking about it, thinking about that answer, meditating on it. God created man, put him in the garden, gave them dominion. Chapter 3, now the serpent, verse 1, chapter 3, now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said to the serpent, we may eat the fruit of the trees of the garden. But of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, we shall not eat it, nor shall you touch it, lest you die. Then the serpent said to them, woman, you'll not surely die. For God knows that in the day you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree desirable to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. And she also gave it to her husband with her, and he ate. And then the eyes of both of them were open, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves coverings. And they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord. Then the Lord God called Adam and said, where are you? So he said, I heard your voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself. And he said, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree which I commanded you that you should not eat? And the man said, the woman, she gave it to me. It's her fault. It's always the woman's fault. Man, it's time for us to stand up and take our place. Quit blaming the women. And the Lord God said to the woman, what is this you have done? And the woman said, the serpent. Now the woman's believing the devil, blaming the devil. We're always wanting to shift blame, never take responsibility. So the Lord said to the serpent, and for sake of time, I'm going to stop. What happened there in Genesis chapter 3 is Adam and Eve lost the authority and the dominion that God gave them. A curse came on all of creation at that moment because of the sin of one man. Romans chapter 5 tells us, gives us the revelation, because of the sin of one man, all of the human race ended up being cursed at that moment. All of creation was cursed. Man died, separated from God. Before had perfect communion. He wasn't trying to hide from God, but the moment he sinned,